Romans 15:29. Tonight we'll be ending our Bible study in Romans, and we'll be moving on to a new book. Romans 15:29. And I am sure that when I am come unto you, I shall come in the fullness of the blessings of the gospel of Christ. Let's open a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege to be Christians. Father, we thank you for your mercy, your goodness. Father, we pray for all the Christians suffering around the world that you'd bless them, encourage them, edify them, and comfort them. So we know you will. Father, we pray that here you'll give us souls in the process of time, that you will rebuild your work, and that you will bring lost sinners to salvation. Father, we thank you for dying on Calvary's cross, loving us and caring for us. And Father, we're going to be faithful. Thank you for the privilege to serve you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, the blessing of the gospel is very simple. It's eternal life, something that every man, woman, and child is in need of. Our life is very short. What is your life? It is a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Each year that goes by, it goes by faster and quicker the older you get. When you're 5 years old, a year is 1/5 of your life. When you're 65 years old, a year is 1/65 of your life. The perspective changes and your life flies by so quickly. When you're young, things take forever to come. When you're old, you wonder where they went. That's the way life goes. Your life is a vapor. And there's a need that you have. It's eternal life. And without that, you're going to be extremely disappointed in the short brevity of your life. Paul, a servant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect, and the acknowledging the truth, which is after godliness, in hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. Now, I believe the scriptures, when God offers eternal life, those that repent of themselves and trust Christ as their Savior, repentance towards God and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, receive Jesus Christ, there's a supernatural operation, they're born again. But notice what it says here. Paul, a servant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect, and the acknowledging the truth, and this is the truth, which is after godliness. When a person is converted and become a new creature, there's a hidden man within the heart that is sinless and that cries out for godliness against the Adamic nature. This is what gives the hope of eternal life, for the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that now we are the sons of God. We have a lot of professing that takes place in a prayer, and a prayer doesn't save you. It's a conviction from the Holy Spirit. It's a repentance towards God. It's a faith in the Lord Jesus Christ that changes a person from the inside out. The hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. The Bible will give you assurance, but your life should be filled with righteousness. Now, I'll use my own self for an example. You can find sins in me. You can find things to criticize. You can find faults in me. But you should have seen me before I got saved. There's a big difference from the old me and the new me. And just because the new me has a lot of little sins to it, there's been a change. And there needs to be a change in the life of any born-again saved Christian to godliness. Those that try to get by and say, well, I joined the team. You can't join the team. There has to be a heart conversion. God has to save you. Now, that's an important thing to understand, because we're preaching the gospel of easy believism today rather than the gospel of faith through grace, which faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Without the blessing of the gospel of Jesus Christ, there is no hope for anyone. That at the time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. When I was driving with my wife today, we were talking, and she was noting how tragic it is for young people. people who lose their parents, and how heartbreaking. That's true, but you know, God has given me the privilege to lose both of my parents, one out of faith and one in faith, and there is a dramatic difference. When I was a young man at 16 years of age, we didn't know the Lord in our family. I was being raised in a lost family. My father died suddenly. I was 16 years of age. It was heart-wrenching. It was tragic. It was bitter. And it left me without hope and emptied and somewhat embittered. Many years later, after preaching the gospel and watching my mother come to Christ, and in the last years of her life, the Lord allowed me the privilege to minister onto her and help her and take her to the doctors because she was succumbing to cancer. I was able to preach her funeral with great peace, great hope, and great expectations. I believe God. I believe my mother was saved. And the two deaths are as different as night and day. And that's a fact, because God's real. And it is tragic to lose a family member, but it's nowhere near as tragic or consequential if they're a saved, born-again Christian. In fact, there's grace and there's hope and there's a day of expectation and more time. But for the lost, all time has run out. God is eternal. Therefore, all accounts settled with God will be for eternity. You must be born again. Go to the great white throne judgment without the righteousness of Christ. You're going to depart for all eternity, hopeless. It's awful to die without God. It's sad to die with God. But there's hope and expectation of another day. I've been without hope and without God in the world. And friend, after 65 years of life, suffering all the things of life that everybody else that's common, I can no more give you this. Repent of your sins, trust Christ as your Savior. Find eternal life in the gospel and have hope. It not only gives hope for eternity, it gives a higher quality life for now. It gives the opportunity of a life of joy in a world of sadness and sorrow. Nothing has changed in all of human history. This truth is salient. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is another name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now, in the last five verses of chapter 15, Paul asked the Romans to pray for him about three things. Kind of a common prayer that people pray. They're a good prayer. Paul's looking for some good things. Romans 15, 30. Now I beseech you, brethren, for the Lord Jesus Christ's sake and for the love of the Spirit, that you strive together with me in your prayers to God for me. Paul's asking for this prayer, and here's what he's asking. That I may be delivered from them that do not believe in Judea. The ungodly will persecute the godly. And that my service which I have for Jerusalem may be accepted of the saints, that I may come unto you with joy by the will of God, and may with you be refreshed. In God's will is perfect peace and perfect joy. This is salient. A lot of Christians are without that peace, without that joy, simply because they're not in God's will, but they're in their will. Paul got out of God's will. These prayers of Paul were not answered because the Apostle Paul was not in the will of God when he went to Jerusalem. God wanted to answer Paul's prayer and would have answered Paul's prayer because he wanted Paul to go to Rome in his time. this is important in life. He had made everything beautiful in his time. Also, he has set the world in their heart so that no man can find out the work that God maketh from beginning to the end. You see, Paul was coming between a self-will and God's will. God's will was that Paul go to Rome. Paul's will and desire was to go to Jerusalem. Paul was called to be the apostle to the Gentiles. Paul chose to go to Jerusalem on the way to Rome, out of the Lord's will and out of the Lord's timing. I want you to see this because this is one of the most godly men that ever lived. This is one of the most faithful men that ever lived. And if we see this in the Apostle Paul, who excels most men in love, service, and dedication, it should be a warning to us of our carnal nature. And now behold, I go bound in the Spirit on Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there. Save, now watch, the Holy Ghost has been witnessing, trying to turn Paul. Save that the Holy Ghost witnesses in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. Now, Paul has a will and desire to his brethren, but Peter has been given the apostleship to the circumcision, and he's been given the apostleship to the uncircumcision, to the Gentile. And he's concerned gravely for his brethren. But God was finished with his brethren as far as Paul goes. Paul was desired to be in Jerusalem. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. Now, it's not that Paul wasn't intending to go to Rome. He was just going to go do something special and then move on to Rome. But by moving out of God's timing, he moved into a loss of joy. And now behold, I know that ye all among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God shall see my face no more. Wherefore I take to you record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. He's speaking to his Gentile converts, and he's planning to go to Rome, which he's not planning on coming back from. And so before he goes to Rome, he just wants to make one last trip to Jerusalem because he loves his kinsmen. Paul was a patriot, but it was not God's will that he go to Jerusalem. It was God's will that Paul move on to Rome. When men get out of the will and timing of God, it usually ends up in a lack of peace, though very often prayed for, it never comes. Now the God of peace be with you all, amen. God answers our prayers in his time and in his will. Very important scripture verses. This is why people get upset and embittered with God when things don't go right in their lives, when they're living their lives to their own will and not paying attention to God's leading and direction and will. These things have I written unto you, that ye believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything, watch this, according to his will, not according to our will, according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he heareth us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desire of him. Now, if Paul had asked for that prayer of his to be answered in Rome, it would have been. Those prayers would have been answered in Rome. But God was not answering them with his going to Jerusalem. That's an important thing to note. If you're going to walk in the Spirit, you need to walk in the Spirit. And you need to be seeking God's will for your life. When we are not in his will, because of the infirmities of our flesh, we do have grace. Now, this is the other thing that embitters Christians. Because whenever there's Christian division, both sides think the other ones are the devil. And that's usually not the case. What it is, they're both of self-will, or one's of self-will. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. The general consequence for a Christian out of the will of God is the loss of peace and the loss of joy. We, in our carnality and flesh, with a desire for vengeance, want God to squash whoever we come into conflict with. And of course, I know a lot of ministers that like to make their adversaries in the Lord the enemy. They want to make them all lost. And the fact of it is, a lot of childish Christians are simply saved babies. Immature, never put it on Christ, never growing up, never being responsible, and never learning it's more blessed to give than to receive. And what causes these conflicts? Greed, covetousness, a desire to obtain. In fact, another thing we reasoned that we were talking about funerals, there was a funeral we attended, and there was family issues in that funeral over the left behinds of the parents. It happens a lot. The parents don't want that. But a lot of times, the children are very covetous, and they'll cut one another's throat, brothers and sisters. If they'll do that in blood families, these same things will occur in God's family. It's not supposed to. It shouldn't happen. If we have a spirit of meekness, a spirit of giving, if we love one another as God loved us, we won't suffer these situations. But when we put something, a good desire, now that's the thing you need to see. Paul's desire for his kinsmen was noble. It was sacrificial. It was for someone else, but it wasn't in God's will. And you need to be careful about that. Nonetheless, God's good. And so Paul, in the infirmities of his flesh and his own self-desire, God doesn't crush him like a bug. God lets him go, but his peace doesn't go with him. Now Paul will still serve the Lord. The Lord will still serve and stand by him, but Paul will do it in great tribulation. Obedience to God in time and judgment is a very critical to the soul's peace and joy in this life. I counsel thee. Now this is very important to understand the scriptures. There's so many practical things in the book of Ecclesiastes that the brethren just reject because they're earthly. Ironically, Ecclesiastes is written for life under the sun, and it deals with a lot of practical realities for life under the sun. And the brethren think, and they get this crazy idea from the devil, that Solomon, writing under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, wrote in his backslidden state and put his backslidden depravity into the Ecclesiastes, and making it the words of a man rather than the words of God. They do greatly err in not knowing the scriptures, nor in not knowing the Lord. I caution you, don't listen to men that diminish the scriptures in any way. This is counsel about life. First, be not hasty to go out of his sight. Stand not in an evil thing, for he doth whatsoever pleases him. That's good advice for under the sun. Where the word of the king is, there is power. And who may say unto him, what dost thou? No one will be able to back God up. God does as he will, because his will is always righteous. And he's absolute power, and it's righteous power. He doesn't have to change anything he does. where the word of the king is, there is power, and it's powerful. I kill, I make alive. That's God. And who may say unto him, what dost thou? So, exhortation, whoso keepeth the commandment shall feel no evil thing. Paul had a commandment to go to Rome. And a wise man's heart discerns both time and judgment. Paul missed it. And Paul's a better man than me. I'm willing to admit that. Paul's a better man than any man I've met in my life. But Paul missed it because Paul put his own personal, sacrificial desire and love to the brethren ahead of his love and obedience to God. Because of every purpose, there's time and judgment. It was not the time to go to Jerusalem. It was the time to go to Rome. Therefore, the misery of man is great upon him. And Paul's going to endure a lot of misery from this. For he knoweth not that which shall be, for who can tell him when it shall be? The Holy Spirit was warning Paul through the brethren. He was told he was going to have bonds and affliction. I don't care. I'll take it on. Paul had the most noble of motives. They were sacrificial. But to obey is better than sacrifice, to hearken to the fat of rams. Paul now acknowledges, as we move on, the churches at Cenchrea. I commend unto you Phoebe, our sister, which is a servant of the church which is at Caesarea. There is no disputing that Phoebe was a woman that was involved in church work. She was a servant of the church at Caesarea. There is nothing restricting women from being involved in church work. However, we do have a clear rule in scriptures for male leadership in the church. Women can be soul winners. Women can work in the church. Women can do a lot of things. But there are four ordained positions in the church that are ordained of God, and all of them require male leadership. But I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. Today, I took the time to reveal something that is not taught, and that is Paul, in a very godly, very sacrificial desire to redeem his brethren, did not obey his Lord and Savior and go directly to Rome. He went to Jerusalem first, and it brought a lot of pain and misery into his life. It took away God's peace. It took away the Lord's joy. Paul would go to Rome bound rather than to walk into Rome a free man to preach the gospel as he's been doing. I say that to say this, because today we have churches throughout the world where the Christians do not know their place and position. There are places, and it's been historical here in this country, that women were held back from service, which they should not be held back from. And then to counter that, women have been thrust or allowed into service where they do not belong. There are clearly no ordained offices in the New Testament church for females. All ordained offices are for men. First office, the bishop. If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly. For a bishop must be blameless as a steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, no striker, not greedy of filthy lucre. A woman cannot be a bishop, a pastor of a church. It's an ordained position, and it's withheld under the common rule. But I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. God some positions. And the position of a pastor of a church, of a congregation, is the sole venue of a man of God, not a woman of God. So every woman in church pastorates all over this country, on television, in a man's position and role, is out of the will of God. Now, God didn't come by and just strike them, but they're not bringing the truth of salvation. They're not bringing the revelation of peace and joy. And they've undermined and messed up the church that it's in a massive apostasy. The only way, and we live in an extremely perverse society, and I'm not going to get into this in detail, that a woman could even fake being the husband of one wife would be to be a lesbian and a moral perversion before a holy God. The next position is the deacon. And there's no deaconesses in the Bible. There's a deacon. The deacon is ordained, and the requirements are clearly given. Let the deacons be the husband of one wife, same as the pastor, ruling their children and their own house as well. Why? Because the woman is not to teach or assert authority over the man. The elders are ordained, and they're all male, mature men. Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in word and doctrine. These are deacons and bishops and evangelists and others. The apostles were all men. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, watch the word, men and brethren, what shall we do? So have four positions. They are the place of male leadership. Now outside of that, women can serve in the church in all manners. They can be witnesses, and they should be. They should be winning and leading people to Christ. They should be faithful. They can sing, and they can teach Sunday school and children. But they should not be teaching the adult men. Now, of course, with some of the brethren that believe that, you're going to get into the what is an adult? Well, the real truth, this has been left behind for ages. An adult child is designated to be an adult when a responsible father says they are old enough and mature enough to take care of themselves and leave the sustenance of the father. That's the biblical truth, but nobody's practicing Bible. In America, an adult child is considered an adult child at 18. But they betray the parent and give emancipation to 16-year-olds and hold a parent responsible after emancipating the child. And it used to be 21. Now, today's society is so slow on maturing children in responsibility that I am not seeing many children mature at 21. However, Phoebe was a very faithful, greatly appreciated saint. That ye receive her in the Lord have become saints, and that ye assist her in whatsoever business she hath need of you, for she hath been a succor of many and of myself also. This woman was a servant, and she was meeting the needs of many individuals. And the men men were told to help her. She wasn't taking a position of leadership, teaching her authority, but they were to help her in her service to the church. A succor is a helper, one that affords relief, a deliverer. Another couple, greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ. Two of Paul's closest, dearest friends and helpers in the ministry. Paul met them in Corinth that had lived in Rome until Claudius Caesar had all the Jews deported. Priscilla and Aquila are a real couple in the Lord. You have a husband with leadership. You have a wife in a supporting role. And she helps her husband in her own knowledge of the scriptures and teaching the scriptures, supporting the leadership of her husband. These two are used to help a young, immature, gifted orator named Apollos. And Paul, after this, tarried there a good while, and then took his leave of the brethren and sailed thence into Syria, and with him Priscilla and Aquila, having shorn his head in Caesarea, for he had a vow. And he came to Euphrates and left them there, but he himself entered into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. You know what pastors and churches need? There's a lot of Christians that want to be servants. We came in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and everybody decided they wanted to be chief. I remember when I was a young man, they had one of these rock songs. It was the Executive Car Wash Blues. The guy wanted to be ahead of everything. He only had the skills to be the head of a car wash, and he couldn't get to be the head of the car wash. That's kind of our culture today. They were all known to the Gentile churches. They had humility. This was a great couple. This is the kind of couple that churches need desperately. The churches of Asia salute you. Aquila and Priscilla salute you much in the Lord. With the church that is in their house, all the brethren greet you. Greet you one another with a holy kiss. They use their house for the Lord. Aquila and his wife were more than Paul's helper in Christ, as they risked their own lives to save Paul's life. These folks were dear, who have for my life laid down their own necks, unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. This couple stuck out their neck or laid down their necks. The expression is like laying your head down for the chopping block. They gave it all for Paul. For the gospel's sake. There is something wonderful about mature, faithful Christians that caused Paul to give thanks to them. My eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land, that they may dwell with me. He that walk in the perfect way, he shall serve me. You will not serve God if you break the rules and with subterfuge attempt to serve God. You can only serve God in his will. Outside of that will, no righteousness, no peace, no joy. And worse than that, calamities can come upon you because of those things. Faithful Christians are much more needed than money. A feast is made for laughter, and wine maketh merry, but money answereth all things. Now see, this is one of those scripture verses that gives you a salient truth of life under the sun. God's revealing it to you. Christian reads, man cannot serve God and mammon. That's true. This is not telling you to serve money. This is telling you that money answereth all things. It pays the bills. Which is a truth. It's not telling you to worship money. It's not telling you to put money ahead of God. But Christians that don't know God and don't know the Bible don't know that God's telling the truth about life. And if you don't think so, that's all this world cares about. This world will kill you for a few bucks. Money answereth all things under the sun. Now, you're not to put your trust in riches. It's not what it's teaching you. For what does a man profit? He'll gain the whole world and lose his own soul. Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? You don't want to put your trust in money, but you do want to learn to be responsible with the money that God puts into your hand. The pursuit of riches is folly for the human condition. Wilt thou set thy eyes upon that which is not? For riches certainly make themselves wings. They fly away as eagles toward heaven. But it does answer all things under the sun. You say, well, how can you qualify under the sun? Because if you read the book of Ecclesiastes, it's all about life under the sun. And it's written by the Holy Spirit. Solomon was not backslidden and writing. It was the Holy Spirit writing to him. Giving you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Responsibility in our earthly wealth is required for possession of the true riches. Say, what are the true riches? Peace, joy, knowledge of God, knowledge of the holy, godly wisdom, godly understanding. If therefore ye have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, that's wealth, money, who will commit to your trust the true riches? If you can't handle your money responsibly, you're not going to be able to handle the true riches. And if ye have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who should give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. You have to put God first. Money is not to be served. Money is to be used for the glory of God, seeking righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. When a man serves the Lord, he learns to control wealth and not be controlled by the money which most are controlled by, which is a defense of the Lord for those that have their money under control. Say not thou, what is the cause that the former days were better than these? For thou dost not inquire wisely concerning this. Wisdom is good with an inheritance, and by it there's profit to them that see the sun. See, this is for under the sun. For wisdom is a defense, and money is a defense. But the excellency of knowledge is that wisdom giveth life to them that have it. Consider the work of God. For who can make that straight which he hath made crooked? In the day of prosperity, be joyful. But in the day of adversity, consider. God also has set the one over against the other, to the end that man should find nothing after him. Yet wisdom of God is better. Wisdom, godly wisdom, the choice of laudable ends in the sight of your Creator is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, not the wisdom of this world, but the wisdom of God. And with all thy getting, get understanding. It's the relationship of things. Every issue of life should be considered in how does it relate to God and my spiritual well-being. Exalt her, and she shall promote thee. She shall bring thee to honor when thou dost embrace her. She shall give to thy head an ornament of grace, a crown of glory shall she deliver to thee. Hear, O my son, and receive my sayings. and the years of thy life shall be many. One of the biggest lies is that the good die young. The world likes to find one miserable old coot that lives to a large age, forget about all the young people that die in their youth from the results of sin, and then likes to find one Christian that steps out of faith and gets nailed, when most Christians that are walking in the Spirit die aged in peace and joy. I've been around. I've seen this. The next verse clearly defines what a church is. And it's a called out assembly. It is not a building. Likewise, greet the church that is in their house. Salute my well-beloved Euphrates, who is the first fruits of Asia, and unto Christ. Greet Mary, who has bestowed much labor on us. This is not the Marys that you find in the Gospels. This is another Mary. Salute Andronicus and Juno, my kinsmen and my fellow prisoners, who are of note among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me. Greet Ampelus, my beloved in the Lord. Salute Urbane, our helper in Christ, and Statius, my beloved. Salute Apelles, approved in Christ. Salute them which are Astrobulus' house. Salute Herodian, my kinsman. Greet them that be of the household of Narcissus, which are in the Lord. This church numbered about 20 souls. I didn't take time to count it. There is a number of false teachings from the expressions who are noted among the apostles, which could mean they were either apostles, or it could note the apostles focused on them for some reason not revealed. These disciples that may have been apostles were in Jesus Christ before the apostle Paul was converted. However, the body does not start with Paul, as taught erroneously. It started with the Lord, and it was first Jewish. This is important for many doctrines. Then said Jesus to them again, "Peace be unto you. As my Father has sent me, even so send I you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them, and whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained." The Lord Jesus Christ has been crucified. He promised before his crucifixion that he would send the Comforter. He's crucified. He's dead, he's buried, he descends into hell, he pays a penalty for our sins, he leads captivity captive, he takes a portion of the people that were in the underworld in paradise and takes paradise up into heaven. That's a whole other teaching to get into. He now has resurrected and he's come back to meet his disciples, and he's coming to give them a gift he promised them, the Holy Ghost. And the church begins here. The body begins here. They receive the Holy Ghost. It is then endued with power for worldwide evangelization. He tells them now, go tarry at Jerusalem until you are endued with power. And they said unto him, "Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high." So all the promises, and the church is starting out Jewish. It's to the Jew first, and after that to the Gentile. The Apostle Paul will not show up until Acts chapter 8. This is before the Lord's departed in Acts chapter 1. This is after the resurrection. He gives the Holy Ghost to his disciples. There is a church in Jerusalem. It's a called out ecclesia. Every one of them are members of his body. They are in the body. The supernatural operation is now taking place by the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is a personage and can operate. Oh, the Bible is so correct with everything. It's not the Holy Spirit is the Holy Ghost. The gospel was first given to Israel, then the world. Paul comes along in Acts chapter 8. He's called of the Lord. He's the apostle to the Gentiles, which we covered earlier. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God on salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greeks. So to the Jew first. And what happens in Acts chapter 9? Peter goes and witnesses to a Gentile. God deals with the Jew. Acts chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Paul gets converted in 8. Peter's, if I got it right, with Cornelius in 9 or 10. I might be off. I think I'm right, though. God's plan is taking place. Now, Paul went with Barnabas to Israel first. Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you, but seeing ye put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. There, Paul is destined for Rome, but what Paul has not finished with, God is finished with. God no longer wants Paul going to Jerusalem. Paul and Barnabas already spoke in the Holy Ghost. Paul's destiny in the Lord, in the Spirit, is Rome. He's going to the world, to the Gentiles. Paul was chosen to take the gospel to the Gentiles. Look at Acts 9. But the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. What he suffers in the abuses of the Gentiles is what's spoken of here. What he suffers in going to Jerusalem is his own fault in not obeying the Holy Ghost. This was the Lord's will for the Apostle Paul, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified, watch, by the Holy Ghost. Peter's apostleship was to the Jews. Paul's apostleship was to the Gentiles. So our two apostles started ministering to the Jews first. For he that wrought effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision, the same was mighty in me toward the Gentiles. Paul starts out as a Jewish disciple and apostle, and he ministers to the Jews as he is learning from the Lord, and he receives the gospel of grace. For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. He calls it my gospel that he takes to the world. And the Jewish brethren confer to this, and they themselves start preaching the same gospel to the circumcision. Which explains why Paul went to Rome in bonds rather than the joy that he had prayed for. And now, behold, I go bound in spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that should befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnesses in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. The Lord was finished with Paul's ministry to the Jews, even as Paul was not finished with his kinsmen. Yet God was not finished with his chosen vessel. You say, why is that? As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes. But as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sake. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. Paul had a gift, and he was called of God to be the apostle to the Gentiles. God wasn't about to change. God knew what he was doing. That day when he called Paul on the road to Damascus, and because Paul had come to the realization that God was finished with the Jews as far as Paul's ministry, that Paul's ministry was now going to the Gentiles only, which Paul himself said when he was with Barnabas. Oh, the human condition. Been there myself. It would seem this small church, in conclusion, a church is a called out assembly. Salute Tephrina and Tryphosa, who labor in the Lord. Salute the beloved Persis, which labored much in the Lord. Salute Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother and mine. Salute Anacatrice, I can't get that one. Phelon, Hermas, Predobes, Hermes, and the brethren, which are with them. Of course, I can always get out of this by saying those Jewish fellows. Salute those Jewish fellows and his sister and Olympus and all the saints which are with them. Salute one another with a holy kiss. The churches of Christ salute you. Groups of Bible believers called out assemblies. It would seem this small church was a target of attack from individuals with doctrine contrary to the salvations and traditions of Paul, which is the common case of all Bible-believing churches. They are the focal point of the attack of the devil. But we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth, whereunto he called you by our gospel to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or our epistle. God is the divider of men when he calls men out from the world. God is not a divider of men in his body, which he wants to be in unity, endeavoring to keep the unity of the faith. But the unity is attacked and challenged by the devil. And the brethren lose focus on God's word and his devices. And they allow gossip and slander and covetousness and pride and lust and everything to come into the church and cause divisions. You say, why is that? They just don't care to take the time to become mature saints, grow up, and be willing to take a loss for the Lord. They think gain is godly. From such withdraw thyself. That's the state around the world today, sadly. The church is under constant attack with false doctrine from the world, the flesh, and the devil. Now that doesn't make a whole lot of baby Christians devils. That makes them fools. Yes, everybody is somebody's fool. Whose fool are you? Paul said that he was a fool for Christ. A lot of God's people become fools for the devil, and the devil plays them like a fool because they are ignorant of his devices. So Paul sends out a warning to the young immature Christians. Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause division and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they are such, serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. Exactly what him and Barnabas said when they went to the Jewish brethren, and they were rejected, and it had been at least the second time. And so they said, we'll go on to the Gentiles. And Paul should have, just like a lot of Christians, Paul should have went to Rome. For your obedience has come abroad unto all men. I am glad therefore on your behalf, but yet I would have you wise unto that which is good and simple concerning evil. And the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. The victory for the church is in the Lord Jesus Christ, not in the flesh. And we'll close the book of Romans here. Timotheus, my workfellow, and Lucius, and Jason, and that Jewish individual, my kinsman, salute you. I, Teterus, who wrote this epistle, salute you in the Lord. Gainest my host, okay, and Tetteras is writing it for Paul as Paul is articulating it. Gainest my host, and the whole church salute you. Etteras, the chamberlain of the city, salute you, and Quartus, a brother. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Now to him that is of power to establish you, according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifested by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of the faith. I personally thank you who have remained here obedient for the faith. For there has not been, in 36 years, any form of damnable heresy taught in this church. The gospel of Christ and salvation through repentance towards God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ has been held to. The traditions that Paul taught has been held to. Has everything been perfect? No, nothing in life is perfect this side of heaven, except the Lord Jesus Christ. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Has anything been excessive? No. We've not had excessive sinfulness in the leadership. Now of him that is the power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifested by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of the faith. To God only wise be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. Written to the Romans from Corinthians, and sent by Phoebe, servant of the church at Caesarea. Excuse me for the agedness in my pronunciation of some of those Jewish fellows. Okay? Now, that's not heresy. That's infirmity. Any questions? That's so simple. So common sense. So easy to be entreated. But boy, you get a little covetousness, you get a little selfishness, you get a little rumor, you get a little slander, and you get a little bitterness, and the devil divides churches continually over and over again, and causing more bitterness. The attempt of any general in a war with armies is to split the other army and to weaken it, so that he can defeat the weaker two sections. That's what the devil does to churches. And Christians just miss it. And we should be endeavoring to keep the unity of the faith. Thank you, brother.